sunny day, spiritual choir, because we're free to express our divinity. Starting right where we are, we're more shining than a star. Right within the depth of our being, we activate real seeing, where we hold the presence that is never an absence as our starting point for life without any strife. We welcome you to Agape. We invite you to feel your way into the frequency of the Most High that's loaded and coded within every cell of your being and all the spaces between your cells. We want you to feel into a sense of awareness that there's so much good trying to happen in your life right now. That there's an overflow of the presence that is surrounding its creation, not absorbed by its creation, and seeking to express more of itself by means of you. We welcome you into this dynamic today. And let me just say, don't leave right after the offering. We do have a special presentation near the end of the service. So a lot of times, like, you want to give your tithes and then check off. No, don't do that. Stay through the whole service. You're reminded, of course, that this month our theme has been soulful success, robbery, limitation and hindrance, and not included. And we've come to a great, great insight, and we're allowing this insight to be activated within us, that soulful success is manifestation that always includes the activation of our soul faculty. So developing an inner intentionality that what we're really about is becoming the next great version and vision of ourselves, that vision that's implanted by the presence of God as a soulful destiny, and that all manifestation that does not include the activation of our soul is what we would call spiritual empty calories. Sometimes it leads to the addiction, the addictive behavior of being addicted to appeasing our acquisitive appetite, sometimes satisfying the surface mind's wants, and sometimes those wants are emanating from what society says is popular at that time, or what corporations are saying what you need to be happy. But we've come to an understanding that soulful success is actually year after year after year becoming more of ourself. Year after year after year, catching the vision that's planted within us and allowing that vision to be the impetus for greater and greater versions of ourself that reflect and reveal the infinite nature of our being. Soulful success is a reminder that robbery and hindrance, limitation is not included within soulful success. Because we are aware, and you're increasingly becoming aware, that as you, more and more and more of you emerges, and as you develop more and more success in every area of your life, it does not detract or steal or rob or take away from anyone else, because we're living in a sea of infinite good that is inexhaustible. So when you rise and begin to embrace the true meaning of your incarnation, and when you rise and embrace the true meaning of your life and what you have to offer, what you have to contribute, and what you have to give, and what you have to activate within your soul, you don't take from anyone at all. As a matter of fact, as we've been discussing this month, you actually add to the mental atmosphere, the noosphere of the planet, and you create waves and wakes of possibility that people can indeed embrace. So this is an opportunity for us to really do our inner prayer work. So we begin to ferret out any sense of guilt about being successful, any sense of guilt about being happy, any sense of guilt about having more spaciousness within ourselves and the activation of more good than we could possibly imagine. All of that is beginning to be dissolved because we're living in a limitless sea of good, an inexhaustible field of infinite potential. And you want to live from that dynamic. Now, the world may temporarily capture you in feeding an acquisitive appetite where you fall in prey to being addicted to getting and getting and getting and getting and using the law of manifestation to get more and more and more and more stuff. But ultimately, you'll become sick and tired of being sick and tired because that will not fulfill you in any way. And eventually, you'll come back to my intention. Is to become the next great version of myself. My intention is to connect with the presence of God within my own soul and to set it free. My intention is to ride the wave of inexhaustible good and be an avenue of contribution and sharing and regeneration and rejuvenation and innovativeness and creativity and resourcefulness. You'll live from that dynamic, and that'll become a part of your subjective tendencies, so that even when you're not consciously thinking or consciously praying, that becomes the activity of your awareness and feeds you and propels you to more good than you could possibly imagine. Things begin to happen in the external world that are vibrational match to that intentionality, and then you'll hear, even before they ask, I've already given it, because subjectively you're already vibrating at that level. I can remember a number of years ago, I used to do a lot of not only lucid dreaming, but leave my body and travel and things of that particular nature. There was a period of time in my life where I was leaving, and I would go to places in the house and try to move things, and then wake up and see if I had moved it while I was out of my body. So one night, I was going down the hallway to move something, and this whirlwind picked me up and placed me in this chair. So I'm sitting in this chair, and there are people in line waiting for me to pray for them. And they were telling me their story of their particular malady or their particular issues, and then I would pray, and they would fade off through the wall in back of me. And this went on all night, so to speak, and when I remembered a couple of people that I prayed for, I actually knew them. Other people I didn't know, but I knew these two people. So I decided to do a little investigation to see the efficacy of the prayer work. I hadn't seen these people in years. I'd gone to high school with them and things of that particular nature. And so one individual that I know, in the dream, he was very sad because he had been cut from the professional football. He was a professional football player, but he had been cut in training camp, and he had played for a number of years. He had a successful career, but he was cut. He was no longer valuable to the team, and he was looking for a job, and he was sad. And the other person was a woman, and she was praying because someone, she had gotten married, and the individual was really a fraud and rifled her bank accounts and left her broke. So I investigated to find out what had happened to these people, and found out that the man that I was praying for was playing football. He was still playing with the team. He wasn't cut. And the woman had not been married. So I thought, okay, this was just a figment of my imagination. However, that year, he was traded to the Rams and cut in training camp, and then found a job at the front office of the Oakland Raiders. They were in Oakland at the time. And the woman, during that year, she did get married, she lost her money, but then she found her soulmate that was a love of her life, that had means and everything worked together for good. So two things occurred for me on that level. One, I was out of time. The manifestation of what they were going through hadn't physically happened. And by being in prayer, I perhaps provided a safe landing space for them for the ongoingness of their life. And two, I began to get a sense that I was being used even as the body was sleeping. And so from that moment on, instead of trying to go out and move things with my mind, I sometimes just go to sleep, and I'm praying when I go to sleep, and I'll just say, okay, wherever I need to be, let me be there. And sometimes I'll say, but I don't want to know about it. I want to sleep a little bit. Just use me as I'm sleeping. Now, I say that to say that when your intention to be of service, as I was saying, comes subjectified, even when you're not consciously participating in it, it will use you. It will broadcast. Your intention will broadcast. Just as people can pick up if you're slick or sly or greedy or a thief, the universe will pick up that you are here to grow, develop, and unfold to become the next great vision and version of yourself. That's what you want to subjectify. And even as you're sleeping, you'll fly on the wings of the Holy Spirit and become a beneficial presence, even as the body is sleeping. And then you will assist in peppering the noosphere, the mental atmosphere, with the beneficial presence. And that will allow other people's easier access into a greater expression of ultimate reality because of the vibration and the frequency that you are emanating and putting into the atmosphere. Soulful success, robbery, hindrance, limitation are not included And then you'll discover that you will begin to celebrate everyone's good. Anybody, if any good happens to anyone, you begin to celebrate it as it's happening to you, because it is, because high tide lifts all boats. And so the culprits of jealousy and envy and rivalry and territorialism and tribalism will begin to dissolve within your egoic structure, because you'll see everyone's success as a dimension of your own success. And then you won't blot or block that dynamic energy from flowing through you because you're jealous of it or envious of it in someone else. Soulful success, constant unfoldment of who you are. And the bonus is that the added thing, seek first the kingdom of God. Seek first the unfoldment of your soul. Seek first becoming more, never less than your true self. And the added things are there. The coin of the realm, opportunities, possibilities emerge for you in this dimension to be a greater contributor of your gifts, talents, and capacities. We are seeking to live in the dynamic of soulful success. And then in that frequency, if people are jealous of you, envious of you, talking about you, you won't be in that world. And all that will do is make you pray. And then you will thank the haters for making you pray just a little bit longer. This is all that soulful sex brings to us. And so in honor of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., whose birth date was January the 15th, though we celebrate it at different days based on the weekend so people can celebrate the holiday, we hear living the dream as the topic of the day, and we bring forth the vibration and the frequency of what that means in living the dream. First of all, you have to have one. There are so many people that don't have a dream. They commiserate with the lower frequencies of the earth and human beings, and they're just trying to eke out their existence day to day to day, living at a vibrational survival ethic, or caught up in the frequency of getting. Individuals may not even have a dream. So in living the dream, the first thing you have to do is you have to have a dream. And that dream has to be big and bodacious, that takes you beyond the comfort zone of the present paradigm in which you are living. And it's not that everything that you dream has to come to pass, but everything you dream will expand your awareness so more of life energy can flow through you. So the first thing is you have to have a dream. And that dream then puts you in touch with the vision that's planted within your own being. And the vision is how God sees you. We're talking about a divine ideal, a perfect pattern, a spiritual prototype of you, that God got you right when you emerged from the infinite as a unique expression of infinite potential. There is something about you that gets to represent God in a way that only you can. That's the vision. And so the dream, when you awake to it, and I often say that the dream is actually a spiritual alarm clock that wakes you up to the possibilities of your own soul, you see. So the first thing you have to do is you have to have a dream. And you don't have to wait and discover how you're going to do the dream. First, you got to have one. And you have to have one for yourself. You have to have one for your family, your nation, and the globe. What is your dream? How do you see the world as in possibility? How do you see your nation in possibility? For the highest and best interest of all concerned, not just for people that look exactly like you. How do you see your dream for your family? How do you see your dream for yourself? And that will take you to vision, you see. Without vision, people perish, you see. So when Dr. King was speaking about I have a dream, he was pulling millions of people into the frequency of possibility for the nation and for the globe. The dream of all beings living together in love and compassion. A dream that a nation would be taking care of the so-called least of us in terms of his poor people's campaign and other movements that he walked with. The dream That individuals, regardless of color of skin and national origin, languages that they spoke, things of that particular nature, would live together in harmony and in peace, and the rivalry and the tribalism from the limited perception of reality that people live from would begin to decay and disintegrate. There was a dream there, you see. And so you have to have the dream. And then secondly, you have to realize that the dream will qualify you. You've heard the statement from time to time, because I've said it from time to time, that God does not call the qualified. God qualifies the called. In other words, you don't have to be perfect to start walking in the direction of your dream. Many people will say, well, I have to get this together first. I have to get this perfect in my life. And then I'll start to live the bodacious dream. Then I'll start to contribute. Then I'll start to be a beneficial presence. Then. But there aren't any perfect people. You don't have to wait. We're talking progress, not perfection. So when the dream begins to be alive in you, and you begin to walk in that direction, talk in that direction, work in that direction, you become qualified. The dream will qualify you. You'll see your blind spots. You'll see your inhibitions. You'll see patterns in your mind. It'll bubble up to the surface to be healed, ways by which you are hindering and blocking yourself. The dream will qualify you, and then there'll be some transformation from transmutation. Those particular blockages that are now being seen, you might need some courage, you might need some patience, you might need some love ethic, you might need to be more generous. You'll see the places within you that need growth and unfoldment, and there might be turmoil in your own soul because you have allowed yourself to identify with those particular blockages. You suppressed them. You created an armor to move through life as a sign and a shield of protection. And when that begins to unravel because you don't need it anymore, it may not be a feel-good day, baby. But you've heard me say that a bad day for the ego is a good day for the soul. That sometimes in that feeling bad, it is actually a lie is being touched by the light of your intention. And as that lie is being touched by the light of your intention, it stirs things up and you feel bad emotionally for a while, but then there is a cadence where there was decadence. You come into alignment and you realize that feeling bad was the clearing out of things that you didn't need anymore. The dream will qualify you, but you have to have one. And then as you begin to live that dream, you will begin to normalize. On a subjective level, you begin to normalize inspiration. You begin to normalize peace. You begin to normalize love. It'll be, right now, there's a normalization of worry and doubt and fear running through the human experience. It's become like a normal conversation. People are afraid, I understand. People's minds have been hijacked by the news. And the blues of the news. You see? And so it's become like normal. People have forgotten their origin. They've forgotten their origin story. In the beginning, God. Not in the beginning, CNN. Not in the beginning, Fox News. In the beginning, God. People have forgotten their origin. And so their mind is hijacked by all the things that are going on in the world. And I understand there are things that are going on in the world. But when you do your work so well, you will begin to normalize a different frequency. You might seem a bit odd in your circle when this happens. A little peculiar, a little different. But going back to the dream of Dr. King, he was not liked when he was alive. He was a bit odd. He was hated by a large part of the nation. The government hated him. Your government hated him, if you're in America. And his own denomination didn't have much to do with him. He wasn't staying within the paradigm of, you know, let's pray, love Jesus, and go to heaven. He said, no, heaven needs to be on earth. We need to take care of people on the planet here. We need to end war as a way of life from a materialistic country. Bit odd. You might be a bit odd in your own circle as you begin to normalize the higher frequencies. And then you'll understand what it means to lean on the presence of God. It's not philosophy. It's not a figure of speech. It is not prose. It's not poetry. It's not a theological something to debate about. When you begin to do the inner work, you'll normalize a different quality of being that will be your shield and buckler. Because you'll be living in the secret place of the Most High. You'll be making the Most High your habitation. You'll be living in God. Recently, Reverend Julie, in her talk, talked about binge-watching your thoughts. It was brilliant, and it flowed out of her. We binge-watch so much stuff. She said, binge-watch your thoughts, you see. And so we add to that, you binge-watch your thoughts. Binge-watch your affirmations. Binge watch the sacred scripture that brings you to a space within your own being where you realize your oneness with God, that God never leaves you, that there's something for you and never against you. Binge watch Isaiah 28. Thou will give him or her perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. Now, many people are inadvertently, the law will give you anxiety if your mind is stayed on the news. The law will give you anxiety if your mind is stayed on all the bad things that are happening. Your mind will make you anxious if your mind is stayed on the lowest common denominator of the human experience. No, I will grant them perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, which is the presence of God. Can you do it for a little bit of time every day? And then something becomes real within you. Now understand this. And relating this back to Dr. King, when he said, I have a dream today, and began to describe the nature of the dream for the nation at that time, that's still appropriate up to this time, he wasn't running away from the facts of the day. He wasn't running away and denying that there was racism and bigotry, segregation. He wasn't running away from the fact that in parts of the country, black and brown people couldn't even vote. He wasn't running away from the issues that were being faced as he was speaking about the dream. He was allowing the dream to capture people's imagination about the possibility so we can live in that higher frequency of inspiration, so that the work we had to do would be pulled from a vision, not pushed by fear or worry or doubt. Put our lives on the line for something that we know would be inevitable, because it's a vision that God has in God's mind and heart. But he knew that peace and love does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, but rolls in on the backs of those who handhold with the higher vision and are willing to do what is necessary. And when you analyze that particular speech, that I Have a Dream speech that is being called to know, that wasn't even the name of the talk. That's what we've come to know about, because that was the crescendo at the end of the talk. But he was saying, in substance, that we have arrived on the Capitol this day to cash a promissory note. And that promissory note had been returned insufficient funds. That America had made a promise about all people being equal, made a promise about the caretaking of poor people, had made a promise. And that promissory note had been returned insufficient funds. So the individuals that were there in Washington were coming to cash a check about the state of the affairs going on in our nation. So he wasn't running away from what was happening. The dream was the movement towards an idea. It was held in the mind of God, you see. And so as you are dreaming, first of all, your dream will actually wake you up, actually. But as you are having a dream, you're not running away from stuff that's happening in your life and in the life of the country. but you have to have something that's pulling you, that wakes you up in the morning, that fuels you, that works through you even when you're tired, that works through you even when you don't feel like, that works through you when you don't want to face what's happening in the world. You have to be able to articulate and feel into the possibility that's trying to manifest, or you'll never experience bliss. You'll only experience the avoidance of pain, and that's where so many people live. That's half living. To move through life, and your whole movement is about, I don't want to feel pain. I'm running to pleasure, and I'm running away from pain. No, we call that living on the waves of the surface of the ocean of bliss. Bliss is the function of the activation of your potential. But you have to have a dream and a vision that helps you activate your potential. Then you can feel the bliss of living. And that bliss of living has very little to do with the external circumstance. I can remember Clarence Chance, who had been in prison for 17 years for a crime he did not do, found bliss in jail. He was studying the art of Krishnamurti's teaching of meditation, and in his 12th year of practicing, he had a deep sense of peace and bliss, body incarcerated, mind and soul free. 5 years later, the Innocence Project took on his case. He was released to discover that those who had set him up in the police department were now higher up in the Los Angeles Police Department. He received millions of dollars for his inconvenience. Point being, the external circumstance didn't change at that moment, but the bliss came from the activation of the potential of his soul, you see. And so I remember attending Holman's Methodist Church when I was a young boy. My mother took me there to see Dr. King speak. And after he spoke, he was in a West Coast junket to raise money for Southern Christian Leadership Conference, the organization that he founded. I remember shaking his hand at the end. My mother brought me up and shook his hand, had a little conversation with him. And after I finished shaking his hand, I remember telling my mother, he has such soft hands. My mother said, he does a different kind of work, baby. He did a real work of vision making and possibility. And he's undoubtedly the greatest citizen that America has ever produced, you see. And so today, this moment, We're inviting the frequency and the vibration of soulful success, subjectifying that everything that I'm about, I'm starting a business, I'm having I have a place of employment, whatever, I'm manifesting money in my life, whatever it is, must be accompanied by and inspired by, I want to be more myself. So at the end of the day, I have not gained the whole world and lost my soul. I've got the bonus of all needs met, but I'm not the same person I was last year. I'm not the same person I was 10 years ago. I'm not the same person I was 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago. I'm a greater version of myself today than I ever was in history. Now, here's the deal. Going back to the dream will qualify you, and you don't have to be perfect. We're just looking for progress. When you embrace yourself and you're able to look at yourself without judgment, that's one of the beginning stages of enlightenment, by the way, when you're able to look at your stuff. Stuff you're hiding from yourself, stuff you're hiding from others, just mistakes you may have made in life, misgivings, missteps, mistalk, whatever it is, but you're able to just, with all of that, embrace it in a non-judgmental way. Something happens. It quickens enlightenment, which is the releasing of obscurations of the mind from seeing who you are, but you become a non-judgmental individual. Because most judgment is coming from the projection of unhealed areas in one's own soul, projecting onto other people. And the more angry people get about other people, it means that there's something within them they haven't dealt with yet. You become not judgmental. And you're enabling yourself to have the power of discernment. We're able to see the presence of God in an individual even when they can't see it. You see? You become, what we like to say, a beneficial presence. You see? Now, I say that because I remember a time way before Agape. I was knocking on the door of Lissa Sprinkles to have a session with her, practitioners. That was her first client that she ever had as a practitioner. I forced her to see me. He said, no, you're a practitioner, I'm coming. And I would pay her, and she would say, baby, you don't have to pay me. You know, because my family, we all lived in family. She was good friends with my mother. And I said, no. You're going to accept this check. But I remember the first time I knocked on her door, I'd had a spiritual awakening. I was awake. But I was still dealing with a level of guilt about missteps that I'd made in my life. And when she opened the door and looked at me, she looked at the Christ. She had this smile on her face, and I'll always remember feeling and seeing what she saw when she looked at me. It like eradicated the burden I was carrying of past mistakes. There was no judgment. It was just, hey, baby, come on in. And I say that because I had that direct encounter of how an individual can actually see the truth in another. But our practitioners here at Agape are praying and seeking to do on a regular basis. So I remember her and my mother, Alice Geneva Beckwith. She would always see the best in me. There was a thing, you see. I want you to begin to embrace the fact that you don't have to be perfect to start working on your dream or possibilities. I want you to do your work so well that you can embrace all parts of you without judgment, so that the parts of you that no longer serve you can be brought into your awareness to be transmuted and transcended, much like we're viewing in the world scene, where everything that has been hidden, not hidden from everyone, but hidden from so many people, are now being seen so easily now. The tribalism, the racism, the bigotry, the police brutality, there's so much that many parts of the population would say, no, that's not true, that doesn't happen, there's no racism in America. You know, all of this can now be seen, it's bubbling up to be embraced and transmuted so that we can move on and actually live the dream in a very powerful and magnificent way. But where does it begin? Right here. It begins in our own awareness, our own inner work. That's where it begins. So, as we scan this, soulful success, robbery, limitation, hindrance, not included. You don't steal from anyone when you expand your awareness. Every good is limitless. You don't limit anyone else's good. You create a wake or a wave of possibility for everyone. You don't hinder anyone's good. You begin to subjectify that everything you're doing, from washing the dishes to starting a new business, it's about the unfoldment of your soul to that becomes subjectified. You want good health? Not for vanity. Health with a purpose is for you to deliver your goods and your gifts and your talents and your capacities, expanding to carry more cosmic energy. You want more money, not just to have money, but money for a purpose, to assist in developing the kind and just global society according to your particular interests. Some of you want to plant trees for the rainforest. Some of you want to take care of the homeless. Some of you want to restructure the justice system so that justice is real. Everyone has something that they want to be about. Some of you want to take care of children. Some of you want to teach. But we have these levels of manifestation for a purpose. And then living the dream, you gotta have one. Bodacious, big, scares you. How am I gonna do it? I don't know. But you gotta have it, it'll stretch you. You don't have to wait till you're perfect, it'll qualify you. You start to normalize the little pinpricks of inspiration you get, That'll become your new normal. You'll binge watch. I will grant thee perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. And you'll become aware that in our nation and other highly industrialized nations, the technological advancements have outstripped the moral and spiritual advancements. We can get online and go anywhere. We got bombs and nuclear bombs and all manner of weapons. Technology is growing by leaps and bounds, but is our spiritual technology keeping up with it? We're invited to be forerunners in that movement. That our spiritual technology and our spiritual practice is keeping up with the technological advances of humans. So we don't end up doing things, getting things done faster and more efficiently with no purpose. That's fascism, you see. The manifestation without love. The control without love. Manipulation without love. No. That's not for you. It's not for the... It's for the children of the Most High. The men and women established in God. Okay, I'm getting to the end of this. Don't worry. So today, living the dream. Have one. Let it qualify you. Normalize the moments of inspiration. Feel what it means like from Isaiah. I shall grant thee perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee. You don't, once you know that, oh my God, your life is different. You have something to really lean on when times are hard, something to lean on when fear is running amok, time, something to really lean on. You want that? I want that for you. I want that for you. So leaning on the Lord is not just a scripture, it's your way of life. Is that freedom? Becomes the order of your day. So then you'll understand, as Maya Angelou said, why the caged bird sings. You understand why we celebrate. It's not frivolous. It's not, you know, running away from an issue. You celebrate the possibility so you can vibrate at the level of the possibility. Because the work that you're doing in the world and the world that you want to create must be created by individuals who are living in the frequency of the manifestation of that world. You can't have a world of love if your heart is closed. You can't have a world where all needs met if you're stingy. You can't have a world of peace if you're in fear all the time. You'll make piss poor decisions. Did I say that? I just heard my mother go, Michael, Michael, I don't edit that out. You gotta be it, and then you'll see it. So we're here to celebrate. This is why we dance. It's why we sing. It's why we praise. It's not what Paul says in the Bible, zeal without knowledge. You know, just emotionalism. He cautioned against zeal without knowledge, emotionalism, screaming and hollering and having no knowledge of the universal principles, having no knowledge about your oneness with God, having no knowledge of how to practice the principles. No, this is not zeal without knowledge. This is spiritual enthusiasm with the knowledge that the power and the presence and the love of God is backing us, flowing through us, and that we're on the right side of the law by affirming the absolute truth, affirming and binge-watching our thoughts, binge-watching our affirmations, binge-watching the scriptures that say something to us, Hafez and Rumi and Dr. King and magnificent Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Howard Thurman, and so many people, we binge-watch that. You can't help but dance. Watch this gentleman, this individual, dance with the Rev. This is Brian McCarthy. Okay, Brian, what you got? Bring me down.
Brian McCarthy! Celebrating the divine presence. Dancing with the Agape Nation. Uh-oh, he's closing his eyes and getting it. Yeah, I love it. Keep sending in those videos. He's got that smile on his face. Oh, look. He's got drum set. He's a musician. Brian, we see you, bro. We see you out there. I hope you tuned in to see yourself. Thank you for dancing with the Rev and allowing the tonic chemicals to flow through the body temple, coherence of the brain, stabilization of our immune system, allowing the blood pressure to be balanced and normalized. All of this is when you pray. All of this is when you dance. All of this is when you become more yourself. Now, right where you are right now, stand up. Because you know what? It's a lovely day. It's a glorious day. This is the day the Lord has made, commanding us to rejoice in it. It's a lovely day. Come on. Here we go.
Morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes. Something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind.
Get on up where you are, make a move, get in the groove, zeal with the knowledge of your oneness.
Just one look at you.
Michael, lyrics. Michael, lyrics in the house.
Love the day. When the day lies ahead of me. Impossible to face when someone else instead of me always seems to know the way. And I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you.
Lovely day.
into the absolute truth that this is the day that the Lord has made. It's a lovely day. It's a glorious day. It's a magnificent day because it is full to overflowing with opportunities. Full to overflowing with possibilities. The spiritual sun is always at a 45 degree angle in our own soul. The sun is always shining even when there's clouds. We have to pierce the clouds of illusion of separation. Transcend the clouds of doubt and of worry. And see, the sun is always shining. It's a glorious, lovely day. What? What? What?
Lovely day.
What?
Lovely day. Lovely day. Lovely day. Lovely day.
You hear that?
Lovely day.
It's a lovely day.
Lovely day.
Wherever you are, regardless of the country you're in, the city, the state, just say, it's a lovely day. Just say, it's a beautiful day. It's a day fraught with infinite possibilities. Now, if you live from that vibration, inspiration will start to flow through you. And then you'll be compelled into right action. It's a lovely day. Woo-wee. Now, take a breath. Allow yourself to become inward. Come on this inward journey with me. Close the outer eyes and begin to go in where it all begins. Began to set you free by inviting real reality. Begin to see the opportunities that are everywhere. Oh, beyond prognosis, beyond diagnosis, there is an idea of your life. It's held resolute and inviolate in the heart, mind of the infinite. Never been hurt. Shelf life forever. Take it off the shelf now. We dust it off. It's our dream of great possibility for our nation, for our world, for our life, for our family. And we turn within now. Ooh, we recognize the presence everywhere. And we begin to see with that which created the eyes. We begin to hear with that which created the ears. So we are seeing and hearing from the Holy Spirit, from the presence of God within us. And we begin to recognize this presence closer, closer than our breathing. Nearer than hands and feet, nearer than hands and feet. And from this sense of oneness with the divine, oh, the word of God is spoken. It's a solar logos. Vibration of the Most High. I speak it for each and every one of us right now, knowing that where we are, God is. And the divine presence is moving through us as divine and compelling right action. Moving through us as all needs met, harmonizing prosperity and abundance. Moving through us as divine health and wellness and well-being. Your body can heal anything. Your body can heal anything. Your body can heal anything. Listen to that. Every organ, action, function of your body made every whit whole. All the organs, all the bones, all the muscles coming into an alignment with the celestial body that is perfect in every way. Oh, we vibrate at that level. Our body can't heal anything.
Yes, my God, you
my being.
Use me.
Oh, let me reveal the abundance that is everywhere.
On this lovely day.
Let me. Let we.
Let it be.
Reveal the love of God.
Let it be.
That is everywhere.
Yes.
The love of God.
Love through me.
No longer suppressed. By our limited perception. But now we hear Mother Mary say, my soul doth magnify the Lord. We're magnifying the love. We're magnifying the joy. We're magnifying the peace. We're magnifying the abundance. We're magnifying the intelligence. We're magnifying the wisdom. We're magnifying the transforming knowledge. We're magnifying that dynamic peace that passes human understanding. I have a dream today. For each and every one of us. Feel it.
My God.
Jennifer, Bam, let them feel it. Feel it. I want you to feel your wholeness. Are you feeling it? Remember, the healing is in the feeling. You gotta feel it. You're separating yourself from circumstances. And you're taking a stand in God consciousness.